Joining us now for more on the markets, BlackRock Investment Institute's chief APAC strategist, Ben Powell. Hi, Ben. Good to see you. Welcome back to Market Edge.
Good morning, Michelle. Great to be with you.
All right. So I want to start with the Fed. All eyes on D-Day. Is there a moral hazard here with the Fed's next move, whether it's one and done, 25 or not, whether a pause or pivot is coming soon, and for how long? What are the risks there?
We think they're going to do 25 basis points later today. And then we at the BlackRock Investment Institute think the Fed will not cut through the remainder of 2023. Why not? Because inflation is too high. So for us, it's a relatively simple problem. It's a huge problem, but a straightforward problem, I guess. Inflation is too high. It is increasingly looking like it is not a COVID thing. It seems like there are other things going on structurally on the supply side of the global economy, which is having a particularly difficult impact on the US. And the Fed is, we think, left with no choice but to continue to focus on inflation, keep rates, raise rates today and keep them there, even as we're seeing signs of some, how can I say, stress or discomfort across other areas of the American economy.
Mm-hmm. And you don't see, you know, a looming US default, you know, softening the stance of the Fed?
No, it's a political issue, a very serious one. I think the creditworthiness of the U.S. is not something maybe that politicians should be playing with, but this is something that the politicians need to resolve. The Fed needs to manage this situation. They're the people who are responsible for prioritization of payments and so forth. But in terms of the political process, the Fed has to just wait and see, I guess, as we're all having to wait and see. We're all hoping there can be a resolution. We're watching closely, but we think the Fed's mandate is clearly not to be involved in a political process. The Fed's mandate is to focus on inflation. Inflation's too high, and that's what we think the Fed is going to focus on later today and for the weeks and months ahead.
All right. And it's not just the Fed this week. I mean, the RBA yesterday stunned the market with a 3.85 hike. The ECB also comes out with a policy decision on Thursday. The Philippines-owned central bank meeting won't happen until 2 months, after 2 weeks, rather, not months, weeks. How fixated are and should central banks be over rate differential with the Fed?
Somewhat, I guess. I mean, it is an important driver, of course, for all of us here in Asia, emerging markets more broadly. But I think we are, thankfully, to some degree, in a different situation. Lots of emerging markets have a less severe inflation problem. I guess the biggest amongst them is China. Inflation in China is only 0.7%. So in China, if they have an inflation problem, it's that inflation is too low, which is obviously a very different set of circumstances. So for the moment, the inflation problem seems to be mostly a developed market issue. That's resulting in developed market central banks having to be more hawkish, even as growth slows. We think that's going to continue. And the difficult challenge for central banks in maybe our part of the world, clearly we need to focus on inflation here as well. But the growth outlook actually looks somewhat more encouraging overall. Inflation situation looks more encouraging overall. And we think central banks in emerging markets have got more room for maneuver because it's kind of very strange, but the inflation situation overall looks worse in developed markets. Normally it's developed markets that are resilient, but it looks worse in developed markets. And those are the guys that have really got the problem to deal with very immediately.
So given your expectations for rates, I know that BlackRock is ditching the 60-40 portfolio in favor of public and private investments and tactical holdings of bonds to navigate this sort of environment. Can you expound on this? I mean, for how long do you see, you know, this breakaway from the 60-40 lasting?
Yeah, so the point we're making at BlackRock is more of a process point. So the era of set and forget, you don't need to worry about your portfolio because everything goes up, which was kind of the very pleasing situation for a lot of the last 15 years, the Great Moderation. Sorry for bad news. We think that is now over. We now have a more volatile, uncertain world. So in terms of thinking about your portfolio, we're all going to need to be working a little bit harder, taking decisions a bit more often and being a bit more dynamic. So the point is really around this change in the macroeconomic and market context, away from set and forget, 60-40 and just don't touch, sadly, towards a more complicated world where we're going to need to be more dynamic in how we build portfolios to try and achieve whatever outcome it is, putting kids through college or anything else.
Mm-hmm. All right. I want to talk about as well another big news story over the last couple of weeks, de-dollarization. We know that the U.S. dollar has always been king, but there's a growing call to move away from the greenback. I mean, Argentina is now paying China in yuan instead of dollars. You've got the BRICS nations looking at launching their own currency as well. Would a de-dollarization, you think, do all of us good?
So I think the dollar is so deeply entrenched into the economic markets reality, which has been built up, I guess, since the Second World War over the last 60, 70 years. And that's not going to go anywhere anytime soon. So I think I should start with the maybe obvious point that the dollar is still king dollar, and that's not going to change for many years to come. But I would say at the margin, we are seeing more kind of, as you're saying, more conversations and more focus around alternative currencies, alternative relationships, I guess, between, for example, energy exporters and other significant geopolitical entities, blocks, and countries. So I think that conversation is going to continue, and at the margin, you might see steps in that direction. But again, the dollar is so deeply entrenched into the basic plumbing and functioning of markets that it's very hard to imagine that changing fundamentally in years and even decades, to be honest. So yes, a bit of that, but the dollar is still the dollar for a long time to come.
All right. Now, going back to the Philippines, the last time we spoke, I think, was 2 months ago, and you said you think the Philippine Central Bank will likely use its strength to feel relatively comfortable doing a bit more instead of allowing inflation to become too pervasive, too broad spread, and too problematic for the economy. Have your views changed, not just on the macroeconomic backdrop here in the Philippines, but your views on Philippine risk assets in general?
So overall, we are overweight to emerging markets. We have this clear preference for emerging markets versus developed markets because, frankly, the situation in emerging markets looks better. Valuations look more attractive. Growth looks more resilient. Some of the negative, headwinds we're seeing in the U.S. and other developed markets, high inflation, banking question marks, let's say, are not so much of an issue in our part of the world. So overall, we continue to favor emerging markets, both equities and actually local currency debt. We think that growth, inflation policy, and valuation dynamic continues to look much more favorable in emerging markets versus developed markets. So we would continue, Michelle, I guess, to lean into emerging markets generally, of course, of which Philippines is an important part.
Mm-hmm. My next question is going to be, when you look at your emerging markets basket, does the Philippines stand out? Are we a favorite? Or are we in the margins?
I would say the overall view towards emerging markets is based on a couple of things. Firstly, the China restart looks increasingly, real and convincing. Mm-hmm. We have a 6.1% GDP forecast for China this year, which we feel quite comfortable about. So China's restart is great, encouraging. The inflation dynamics look much better. And I think a lot of that obviously pertains quite closely to what's going on here in the Philippines, And there's no reason why the Philippines shouldn't benefit from some of those tailwinds that I'm talking to.
All right. On that note, thank you so much, Ben, for joining us. Always a pleasure speaking with you. Have a great day.
You bet.